Welcome to Must Know ADU Strategies for 2023, presented by ADU Resource Center. I'm your host, Danny Johnson. The goal of this broadcast is to create an informational hub for homeowners planning an ADU project of their own. This will be an ongoing webinar beginning in January of 2023 with special guest speakers from our industry so you can get a variety of tips and information to strategize your very own ADU project. Some of the topics we're going to cover are updates and tips for financing solutions, information on the CalHEPA ADU grant, and new legislation laws for ADUs and more. ADU Resource Center began building custom and tract homes in California and Florida back in 2010. In 2020, new legislation changed ADU restrictions for most city ordinances in California. We saw this as a new opportunity and wanted to pitch in and help affordable housing solutions. That's when we changed our DBA to ADU Resource Center and never turned back. Our company is now ADU specific, meaning that's all we build. Since our transition, we now have over 300 plus ADU projects in various stages of permitting, planning, and construction. We are well on our way to becoming the fastest growing and largest ADU builder in California. Southern Californians have chosen ADU Resource Center as their first choice for project concept designs, architectural design, structural engineering, Title 24 engineering, low impact development planning, plan submission, revisions and retrieval, licensed general contracting, landscape and hardscape design all under one company so we can effectively manage the entire project from beginning to end and to streamline better communication, coordinate smoother handoffs between divisions and teams, and reduce mistakes with more eyes on your project. And now, let's begin our program. All right. Welcome, everybody. Let's go back to our list again. For the people that logged in late, I want to show you what our topics are going to be tonight. And these questions came up from our last webinar in January. So again, if you have questions, there's a chat feature down below. Just type them in. We'll try to get to them towards the end of the program tonight. But how to know if your ADU will, what kind of ADU can you put on your property? Is it possible? Can I create the vision I have in my head? In other words, some of you have an idea of what you want. You're just not sure if it's possible. We'll let you know. How big of an ADU can you build on your property? Do I have the room to do what I hope to do? What shape or design best fits my property? And what are my options? What's it going to look like inside and out? Do we have any way of showing you ahead of time? Yes, we do. How much is it going to cost? The recommended project budget. Very important in the beginning that we understand that it's going to be difficult for contractors to give you bids this early. That's like asking you to say, hey, how much am I going to spend at a restaurant? I don't know. What are you going to eat? I'm not sure yet. What restaurant are you going to go to? I don't know. Well, I can tell you if you put $200 in your pocket and leave your wallet at home, you'll not spend more than $200. But that's the only thing we can tell you. The rest is going to be determined once you get there. So like that, the architectural plans and engineering are going to determine what your project cost is going to be. But what we can do is give you a pretty good budget recommendation on where we think your project should be. And if we're in the neighborhood, good, we can get started. If we're too high and it's still a little bit much for your budget, we have ways of retooling and scaling it back so we can fit any budget. The last and most important thing is how can I finance? A lot of people have a good mortgage rate right now that they kind of don't want to mess with, right, Shara?
Yep.
And if you have a rate that you don't want to mess with, but we want to use equity, there are ways that you can finance your project using the equity, which is the lowest rate possible, without interfering with your existing loan. So I'm going to just say hello to that person right now, and that's from the Stowers team. And we have Meredith Stowers from the from Cross Country Mortgage that's going to be telling us about how a little bit later in the program is how are what are your options and best options to finance your ADU. Hi, Meredith, you there?
I sure am. I'm really excited to talk about our new construction HELOC. It has solved so many problems for people, and we'll talk about that shortly.
Okay. Your mic is hot, and because you're an expert in this industry, as we go through, and I'm going to introduce the customer care division, and we're going to talk about all these questions that came up so we can answer them one at a time. Your mic is hot. Feel free to chime in anytime you like. So on my right, I have Sean Sarabi. He's the Director of Operations.
Hello, everyone.
Vic, are you off camera?
Yes, I am, but I'm right here. That's my hand.
Vic Ademian, he's the co-managing partner of ADU Resource Center. He's where the buck stops, really, actually. On my left over here is Mike C. Now, I have to say, we call him Mike C because we have how many mics? Five?
Yeah.
Five mics. Mike C, Mike V, Mike G, and Mike K, and
Mike D.
Yeah. So this is Michael Koromokos, but we call him Michael C. Mike, what territory do you service?
So I'm in the greater Los Angeles area, Glendale, Pasadena, and northern parts of Los Angeles.
All right. Mike Vitito, Mike V, say hello, and what service area do you service?
Good evening and happy February. I'm in charge of Orange County and the Inland Empire.
Aha. Uh-huh. Okay. Daniel Maxwell, say howdy. You're muted. He's muted. Try now.
Hey, this is Daniel and I'm in Greater Los Angeles.
And are you actually, you're downtown Los, you're down by Hollywood, right? So you're right in the yep. thick of the golden zip code stuff down there. Chris Martin, I know you were having a little problem with your video earlier, but it looks like it's working now. Can we hear you? Let me see. Let me try hitting. Try to unmute yours, Chris. There you go.
Yes, I'm in the San Gabriel Valley, and I go into the Inland Empire.
Inland Empire and part of San Gabriel Valley, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Good, good. Tony Rossini, welcome. Let me see if I can unmute you. Try now.
There we go. Good evening, everyone. Yes, I'm in the primarily in the San Fernando Valley and Ventura County, Simi Valley, Thousand Oaks, Santa Clarita Valley.
Wonderful. Mike G, these are all the customer care team members on staff. And we're going to be working tomorrow morning calling everybody on the registration list tonight. So if we missed your question, well, don't worry. We'll answer it tomorrow. No problem. We'll be able to take our time without the clock ticking. Mike Garcia, or Mike G, as we call him, the Godfather. Tell me your territories, buddy.
I'm in Greater Los Angeles, surrounding areas, Whittier, Southgate. However, I'll drive wherever I need to go.
And I think also North Orange County is also in your wheelhouse too, isn't it?
That's right. That's okay. Right.
Let me see if we have anybody else logged in from our team. I don't know if we have anybody from San Diego logged in right now. I'm looking. I don't see Timothy or Susan yet, but
we have Sharon on.
Sharon? Where's Sharon? Dr. Barnes. Dr. Barnes is she's one of our ringers. She actually has her own consulting business, but she helps us from time to time. Hi, Sharon.
Hello, hi everyone. I'm an empire for anybody who needs some help.
All right. And I don't see San Diego or the San Diego team on there right now. So we'll just kind of leave it at that for now. But why don't we do this? Why don't we dive into the promotions and let's just see what we got on the honey-do list. I want to talk about, let's go back to this. So tonight we're going to go through these questions and the whole idea is we're going to answer all the questions for you. There is easy steps, easy as 1, 2, 3, and we're going to show you the formula on how we go about doing this. One of the things that's interesting, or at least probably convenient for us since we are ADU specific, we've really got this down pat with over 300 projects under our belt. I mean, we did stubbed our toe in the beginning like everybody else, but I think we're getting much better at it now. So now it's smooth sailing and we're going to show you our process and how we recommend you tackle it, whether it's with us or somebody else, but hopefully with us. And at the end, you will be all knowing, you will be a great and powerful ADU Oz with inspiration, ideas, answers, and solutions. I promise you, it's a money back guarantee. And so how much did they pay tonight for this webinar, Mike?
A grand total of big fat
zero. So that'll be easy. That's an easy guarantee. Okay, so good. So let's go. Let's dive right in. Let me show you a program that is going to interest everybody, I think, I hope. And here's how I can tell the demographics of our group is by who recognizes these people. Anybody recognize them? Hey, Christian. All right. You got to listen. If you're not over 45, you don't know this guy to my right. I said, you know who these people are? He goes, I don't have a clue. So I said, okay, you're a youngster. So there's many reasons why we need an ADU. Mom is coming to live with us and we need an ADU. Dad is in assisted living and it's $5,000 per month. I need an ADU instead. I need retirement strategy, I need an ADU. Social Security isn't enough. We need more income. I need an ADU. I have a growing family. I need more room. I need an ADU. I need mailbox money. I need a ADU rental. Okay. So get an ADU. It's no big deal. Let's show you how we can do it. The first thing that we do on our team is that we do have kind of a 1-2-3 thing. The first thing we want to do is do a feasibility check. Now, what we like to do is we like to schedule a phone call just to do a little meet and greet first and answer some questions. But if you want to do a Google satellite meeting, I think this is probably the most clever, because with technology, we can look down at the property and we can actually map out shapes and sizes and see what's going to fit best. We can find out what's going to work in there. If we say that, yes, all of this can be done, or in some cases, no, it cannot be done. And we'll show you why. But we'll make an alternative suggestion. And if everything looks good, we want to eventually do an on-site assessment. And the primary thing is on the Google video call, we've done most of the heavy lifting. We could pretty much even give you a budget of where the price range would be of the project. If it still looks like it's in the wheelhouse, most of the heavy lifting would be done on the feasibility check. So then we're going to go to the on-site and look for any hazards that we couldn't see. Any red flags, and we'll get to that. I'll explain it. At the end of it, we want to try to come up with an accurate budget that's realistic. A lot of customers think they want to spend X amount of dollars, and it's not nearly enough to do what they want. I see Meredith smiling already right now, so I know she has an opinion on that. And we're going to say be fearful of low bids, because it's way, way too early to get a bid from anybody without plans or engineering and all that stuff. So let's just dive in and let's just see how's this all work. I think if you're thinking about doing an ADU project, the first thing is you got to decide who you want to call. And it can either start with a phone call or a video consultation. I'm going to show you an example in a minute of what a video consultation looks like. And again, we're looking for feasibility. Is it possible to do what we want to do? And is the scope of work able to, can we demonstrate it on screen? Yeah, in most cases we can. So let me move this out of my way so I don't have to look at that. So we're looking down. This is a screenshot we take of an example of a Google video meeting. So we'll look at the property. We'll kind of toggle it around at different degrees and kind of look at it from varying areas and say, okay, let's just assess the area of what we've got back here. There's a variety of different ways we can do it. You may have one idea in mind, but there may be plenty. So if the idea that you have either won't work or it's not feasible or it's not legal, believe it or not, sometimes they're not legal what you want to do, we'll show you an alternative. So what we then do is we say, okay, let's take a look. Are there any structures back there? Yes, there's a garage. First thing we do, let's say, okay, we got a garage. It looks like it's got a measurement of 530 square feet. What was your plan? What was your vision? Well, we're not sure. We're thinking we want to do an ADU, but we don't want to wipe out all the backyard. We want to eventually put something back here for either mom, dad, or a renter or whatever, but we don't want to wipe out the entire yard. So then we start looking at options. How many different ways can we build an ADU? Well, we know we can do a garage ADU. And if you say, well, I don't want to do a garage ADU because I want to use it as my garage. I got stuff in there. I got cars in there. So we'll start looking at other ways to expand. So we have at least a garage ADU. We've got expansions off the garage, at least three different options there. We can also attach off the main wall. They don't have to connect. They just have to touch and have a common wall. And we can have people do attachments like that. If we do a detached and it's standalone, we can do that. So, I mean, there's at least 9 different options in this image alone. So we want to just kind of talk about what is the best fit for you and what is the best fit for the project budget. Okay.
something to consider. If we're doing a detached, Michael, sometimes look at the angle of this yard. It's not exactly right angles, right? So we have to be mindful of setbacks. So what are the setbacks for people to pay attention to on detached?
As a rule of thumb, 4 feet is going to be your setback from your side yards and your rear yard setback. There are some other exceptions, so keep that in mind. We will discuss that when we come out to your house and visit on an on-site assessment.
So this right here represents 10 feet between the building and the detached structure, and these two sides would be 4 feet, correct?
Correct.
Okay. Dan Maxwell, if we wanted to do an attached ADU, let's say they wanted to keep the garage unit intact, but they may want to expand off it, use the garage as the ADU plus a little expansion area. What's the maximum square footage most ADUs can be in California? You're muted.
Yeah, I can't unmute. So it'd be 1,200 square feet.
Yeah. So in this example, what we've got, we're paying attention to the 4 foot setback over here. But the previous example, we could only get 564 square foot if it was detached. But on an attached, we can also use this and this. So combined, it's 1,200 square feet. And then we still have plenty of room, and we haven't wiped out the yard over here, correct?
Yep.
All right. Same thing. We can go either left or right. We can go up and down, whatever. But what we find out first is what is the maximum size you can build. It may not necessarily be the size you want to be. What we want to find out, is there any limitations on size? And so far, the answer is no. It's blue sky. We can do. We can put in as much a larger unit as we want. Let's see. Mike V. If we were going to do a detached, what do you think? Is this the best location for a detached if they wanted to do 1,200 square feet? Hang on. Let me unmute you. Sure. Can you unmute Mike?
Mike Garcia.
Oh. Still muted. Okay, Mike, try now.
Okay.
Let's swing around to him.
Huh?
Let's swing around to him next
week. All right, Mike, we're going to have to come back to you. Sorry, we technical difficulty. Okay, so here's the thing, Mike C. Is this the logical place for a detached?
Hey, it could be. Maybe that 1,200 square foot in the back right section of the yard could create a private backyard space for that ADU.
What if they said, I think I want to do an L shape and put it in the corner, but I don't want it to touch the garage. So how's that looking?
That would work really well, especially if your ADU was to be shared with a family member. That way you have a shared backyard space between the main house and the ADU.
I think the only thing we got to be careful of is if we're being mindful of this setback right here, we know it's going to affect this area more so than this, right? Mm-hmm. And so if we now do right angles, because they won't let us do diagonals, will they? Right? So if we stay right angles, we got to be careful, because now could this become too narrow to where it's unfeasible?
Yeah, things could get a little bit tricky, but man, we're pretty creative.
Okay, yeah. I don't know. I think sometimes we want to look at this. That's why I think sometimes a video call works well, because we can experiment with shapes and see what works right to our eye well before we get to the property. And then when we get there, we can drop down some red flags and stand back and have a look. But I don't know that necessarily if they said, look, I kind of want to do an ADU that's an L shape and put it in the corner. If we had a straight fence right here, that might or might not work. But here's the only troublesome thing. The width between here and here is quite narrow. So I don't know that we'd get the floor plan out of it that we would get on this one right here. But again, each property is different, right? Attached is your friend. Okay, Tony. Let's see if I can unmute you. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. All right.
So, Tony, what do you think about attached ADUs versus detached ADUs when we have a space problem?
Yeah, like you mentioned, attached is your friend for a few reasons. If space is an issue, you convert what you have. If roof line is good on the existing, bottom line, and I'm sure several people on this call, budget wise. Cost tends to be a lot less on an attached unit versus a detached from ground up. And not to get too lost in the weeds, but with the rules on solar, you don't have that as an impact as well.
So it's a money saver as well, huh?
Yeah, big time money saver.
So here's the thing. If we do a detached, we know we've got setback rules staying 10 feet away from structures and 4 feet away from property lines. But on attached, we do not. We have a much more open field, don't we?
That's correct.
I also think, Meredith, don't we also get a little bit more loan to value on some of your loans if we do an attached versus detached, or is it opposite?
Yeah, no, we get a little more value if it's attached. And oftentimes we can go up to 110% of future value. And what I like about it is the privacy. You can still, designed right, you still get the privacy.
Okay. In this case, what the goal was, let's say that the homeowner says, I want to keep my garage. I want a garage. I want to park maybe some cars in there, or I might want to keep one half of it storage, whatever. What are the advantage of the attached design ADU is that it eliminates this 10-foot setback from the building like we had on the previous example here. This had to stay 10 feet away. And so as you can see, we're very, very limited on what we can do here in size. Even when we stretched it out, you can see sometimes the shape doesn't really hinder what we want to try to do. So sometimes doing an attached, we can get far more creative. And it's sometimes the best choice for small backyards because it gives us more square footage and less city ordinances to deal with. Here's a good example. That example of a detached earlier, that was only 500 square feet, right? Now we've got double that practically. So already we can see that an attached solution right here can make a lot of sense. So depending upon who you are and what your property looks like, if you're tight for space and you have these setback issues and you can't get the size you want, attached may be your friend. It allows more open space so the yard isn't splintered, okay? What's another way we can do? We can even attach, we had that 900 square foot example up there, but we can even attach this one over here and eliminates that 10-foot setback that was in between those others over there. And what I think is interesting about this design, let's say that this is a rental and the tenant, let's say, is going to live in the ADU. So the garage could be a shared parking or it could be for the main house. But regardless, if the garage is going to be a garage, this is the ADU. So assuming there's a little privacy barrier that'll eventually go there, separating the main house from the ADU. What I like about this is now what becomes of this, Shara, right here.
Backyard space?
Yeah, courtyard, private courtyard for the ADU. So the interesting thing about doing it like this is now we can get usable space. So if the main house has this area over there as their backyard, their designated space, even with a privacy barrier separating the properties, we still have plenty of room over here to do a private courtyard and a walkout patio. So this could be a great thing. If the outside is an extension of the inside, how much space could this represent? It could represent another 800, 900 square feet. So you add that to the 1200 square foot that we have there. This could be a massive living area that could bring top dollar on rental. That's the point.
I was going to say that something like that would add an additional $500 in rent easy. People pay good money not to be in a little apartment.
Okay, so Meredith, while we're talking about this, one of the questions that did come up a lot is homeowners are in disbelief on what rentals were bringing nowadays because we saw COVID and we saw it's like they dropped fertilizer on our homes and they all shot up in value. But the other byproduct of that is we got a lot of rents that went up, because a lot of when housing in general goes up, rents go up, and they went up dramatically to the point where I don't think anybody has any idea what market rates are right now. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Housing prices went up, but rental prices went up 3 to 4 times that. We'll show you how to find the rents in your neighborhood, because you will be shocked.
Yeah, it's and like I said, if you build it, they will come, right? So if we create an extended area that is going to be a complement or an extension of the ADU living area, the combined living area could be close to 3,000 square feet. That's going to bring big, big money, right?
Absolutely.
Okay. All right. A lot of people want to know, what are we going to do? How are you going to connect the ADU to the utilities? How does all that stuff work? So one of the things that we can do is they will let us piggyback the electrical and water off the main house. Okay. The only thing is that the electrical panel on most houses are for one house. So they're typically 100 amp. And if we are now going to piggyback a second one, let's say it was going to be a garage ADU. Well, it's going to have an HVAC system in there. It might have a washer and dryer. It's going to have appliances, we know. So the one thing we want to be mindful of is if we're going to be running them both at the same time, we don't want to be blowing fuses or circuit breakers. So what we recommend is if you've got 100 amps for one house, you need 200 amps for two houses. So we recommend that you upgrade that panel to a 200 amp, and that's problem solved. As long as the water is nearby, we know how to get to it. The only thing they don't want us to do is they do not want us to share the main sewer line of the main house for the ADU. And it's pretty obvious why. The diameter of that sewer pipe, and let's call this red arrow here, the sewer pipe going out to the street from the main house. This is designed for as many bedrooms are in this house. And let's just say it's a 3-bedroom house. So there's enough people in there that they think this diameter is suitable. But if we added another 2-bedroom ADU over here, that may be too much use, and this diameter could be too small, and therefore it'll clog the main house. We don't want two houses clogged with sewer. So they recommend we detour and go around the house and pick it up on the backside. Once we're 10 feet past the main house, we can pick it up. So this line represents the utility trench for the sewer so that we can get to it. And now everybody's happy. If we do have a clog in this dwelling right here, it's not going to affect that, and vice versa. Let's see, what else? We had a customer ask last time, what do we do if we have a lower than, let's say the backyard is lower than the front? So let's see, Mike V, can I hear you yet? You're still muted. You are still muted. Not your day. All right, Tony, you got any ideas on what would we do if we had to go, in this case, it's 141 feet, and we think that the backyard might be about 5 feet lower. So the rule of thumb for sewers is it's done by gravity, and it's 1/4 inch for every foot. But what do we do if we have an ADU target spot that's lower than the main house? Now it's got to go uphill a little bit, at least for a few feet.
Yeah, that's a problem. No, I know. I'm just kidding. Some sort of pump, right? Would that be the best option?
Mike C knows.
So what we're going to have to do is dig down a little bit and create a sewage pump. It will have to run electricity to it, and that pump will bring that sewage up to a higher height so it can continue flowing downhill again. But it's a little bit tricky. We just need to make sure that we have electrical run to it, and it's a place that we can dig and place that pump.
In Calabasas and Malibu, where they have all those canyon homes, you've seen them on the side of the hill. Some of them are down in the canyon, and the street is up higher. So you can imagine that requires a pump to get it up to the street. It's nothing big deal. That's what they do on canyon homes or on sloped homes. They just have to put an inline sewer pump, and problem solve. So if we have a long distance that goes exceptionally long from the target property back here where the ADU is going to be to the front, we just put an inline sewer pump and call it a day. All right. So let's say we do all of this on the video and everything looks good. Everything says, okay, but tell me more. What do we need to do? We now want to go look for any red flags or hazards that were not visible on the Google satellite. So what does that mean? We can learn a lot from the video call alone, but we still need to do an online on-site inspection. If it's a garage ADU, we need to keep an eye out. I want to look at the quality of the wood in the garage. I had a call today on a client that the house was built in 1920 something. So we know the wood is 100 years old. And in his case, he wanted to build an ADU over the garage. We may want to look at that wood and say, is this something that we trust? Is the integrity of this 100-year-old wood good enough to satisfy us where we are going to build something on top of it and not worry about the integrity of the structuring and the engineering? Maybe, maybe not. So the first thing that we want to do when we're on site, especially if it's going to be a garage, we're looking for termites, we're looking for black mold, we're looking for dry rot, and we're looking for power poles. And we're looking to see if you are in a floodplain. So if you're in a floodplain, we want to make sure that we know where that water is going to be. We don't get that much rain in California. We get a whole winter's worth in one day, but that usually floods somewhere. So we want to make sure it doesn't go flooding into your house. So the on-site inspection actually is just sort of the final part of it. We did most of the heavy lifting already on the video call, believe it or not. Kind of know where we're at on the scope of work. We kind of know where we're going to be at on budget. We kind of know a lot. The only thing we don't know is up close. So we just need to poke our head inside the garage and walk the property and see what that slope looks like. And if there's anything that we need to pay attention to, we do need to stay 5 feet away from the power poles and 6 feet away from the power lines. The lower lines are the communication lines, cable lines, which are not big deal, but the high voltage lines are the ones up on top. We got to be mindful of that if we're building a two-story. If you live on a slope, this is what we want to see. Where is the ADU going to be and what sort of foundation is going to be required? If it's a mild slope, we know that you're going to require a certain type of engineering for that ADU to sit on, and it's generally going to require a retainer wall. Now, the retainer walls look something like this right there, and it's designed to hold soil back from erosion. And we've put one behind it and one in front of the ADU so it doesn't go sliding into the main house and go down the hill. If we are on an extreme slope, it's going to require caisson pilings, which are what they would build on custom homes in Malibu. And you've seen them. They're on stilts. But in this case, they're made of cement. They go straight down into the bedrock, and they keep the house. We don't have to worry about displacing this with a bulldozer and try to flatten it. It's a waste of time. The easiest way is put the pylon straight in, build a flat foundation on top of it, and that's usually what you do when it's extremely sloped. If we have multi-tiered property like downtown LA has a lot of narrow lots and they're in the hills of Los Angeles, we have to take a look at that because it could be a problem if we don't have access to get a bobcat back there. We have to make sure that if we're gonna carve out a section where the ADU is going to sit, we have to, is a bobcat going to fit back there? If not, then it's going to be labor intensive and it could affect the project budget, all that stuff. We talked about the ADU being below the main house. We know what that's going to involve. We want to make sure it's not in a floodplain. And if we know how far away the main sewer line is at the street level. There's a process called underpinning on second story projects that we have to reinforce the foundation below on the lower level before we can add the weight of the second story on top. So these are the things that we will look at on the on-site visit. Here's a look at a 100 amp panel for one house. There's a look at a 200 amp panel, as you can see right there, and that's going to basically get things ready to go. Okay. Once we figure out where we're at, do we have any of these, if any? If we don't have any of these red flags or hazards, then we can reconfirm the budget that we talked about on the telephone. If we have one or two, then we will adjust the pricing accordingly based on what we see at the time and give you our recommendations on what we feel is probably a realistic and sensible project budget, whether it's through us or someone else. We want to confirm the final recommendation quote over that we gave you on the video simply by looking at the things in person. And once that's all set and it looks like it's a go, the next order of business is we need to figure out how is the best way to finance this. So knowing the numbers is a must. And without knowing the full story, the project costs are just big numbers. So we want to look at what's the current rental trends in your neighborhood if it's going to be for a rental. I think Meredith is going to dabble on this, but in my opinion, if it's going to be, we have ADUs for growing families, whether it's for your family is just outgrowing the size of the property that you have. Mom and dad may be coming back to live with you for whatever reason. Okay. More and more, this is the first time we've seen three generations living on the same property again for the first time in the last 80 years. And it could be a sign of the times. It could be the economy. I don't know, but it's happening more and more and more. And the ADU laws are facilitating that and allowing that to happen. So let's take the case of mom that lives on her own, and she may be getting up there in age and you don't want her to live by herself. Well, build an ADU out back and let her live in it. And then she can have breakfast with the grandkids every day until she's no longer there. And I think she'll love it. And so will everybody else. So the rental exchange or the amount that you're likely to get on rent, if it's for a renter, is staggering. And I think it's going to basically offset the cost of building it. And this is sort of going to be the, in my opinion, how the whole thing comes into play. So I'm going to take a break and take a drink of water. Meredith, maybe this is the best time for you to pop in and talk a little bit about how does one, if we figured out a minefield's only a minefield if you don't know where the mines are, right? So if we show them where the mines are, we make it through, it's just a walk in the park. Assuming that everything is smooth and easy, how does one go about financing in a time when interest rates are not what they were?
You're muted.
I love saying that. I'm a gag.
I know. Bossing me around is true. So I know inflation is, and fear is, you know, media make money on that. But the reality is, it is unbelievable how much rental income is and really how inexpensive ADUs are. And running the numbers is part of your very first steps before you spend a dime of money. And the reason why we run the numbers is a couple of things. Number one, the guys need to know what budget are they designing to. Are they designing, you know, can you afford a $300,000 ADU or just $100,000? What's the monthly payment that you are comfortable with? So we're also going to take a look at optimizing your rental income, right? So a lot of people think they need to build this huge three-bedroom unit to have the max rental income. In fact, we often find that what we call ADU duplexes, a one-bedroom and a one-bedroom, is the best rental income there. And every neighborhood is different. I'll show you how to do it. So let's start with what can you do? First of all, I want to talk about not just ADUs, but SB9 units. So the state has upzoned. So now you can take a single family house and build up to 4 units on any given property. What is an SB9 unit? Well, an ADU, the name for an ADU is an accessory dwelling unit. It's an accessory unit to the mother house. It's a granny flat, right? But the loan guidelines say that, you know what, we're really not allowed to factor in future rental income for the most part on granny flats. SB9 units, though, the state law says you can have a second house on there. And to a large degree, we can factor in future rental income on that. It's all the mortgage guidelines do not fit the loan, the permit guidelines, but they're catching up and there's ways to go around it. So that's also part of the reason we want to talk, because sometimes we do multiple phases in construction and permits, and we've got to collaborate that on that together to get everything you want in the system. What do these things cost? Well, I work with over 300 contractors across the state. These guys are the bomb. And I can tell you, I know what these cost across multiple contractors. An attached ADU typically costs about $100,000. Today, at high interest rates, that's about $500 a month. And it's going to rent for about $2,200 to $2,500 in Los Angeles. And also San Diego. The detached units tend to be between 200 and 250, but that's just about $1,237 per month when rates are down. Keep in mind, rates are already coming down. Fannie Mae is projecting we'll be at 4.3% in about 9 months, and the rents have gone way up, again, three times. The guys will tell you why it's different, but I just know that when somebody says detached ADU, I know what my costs are pretty much going to be. And how do I know that? Because I see all these bids from all the contractors, and my worst case scenario is a lowball bid. Every time I see a lowball bid, it's because they've deliberately or unknowingly forgotten something. And that's a great way for them to have come back and say, oh, I need $50,000 more. Good luck with that. That makes me so mad as a lender.
And does that happen?
Oh God, all the time. There's always a contractor who's going to try to get your business by lowballing the bid. And inevitably they circle back and say, you know, hand out and say, well, I need more money. Oh, and or I didn't include that in the bid. You'll have to pay extra for that. Now, no, Marilyn,
I don't want to stop you, but I just want to make sure that everybody knows she doesn't work for us. She's neutral. She's Switzerland. So this is coming from a neutral third party. This is her opinion of all the contracting business in Southern California. You know, we caution people about taking the lowest bid out there because it sounds good. I think there's a loss of sensibility where people decide, I want to see how cheaply I can get this done. And be careful what you ask for, because there's people that will tell you what you want to hear. And that's where we get the contracting nightmares. And you know who I blame? I don't blame the contractor. I blame the customer, because they became naive. It's like all of a sudden their sensibilities went out the window and they said, show us the candy first, then we'll get in the van. We're not stupid, you know. And so yeah. I think what we need to think about is building is cheaper than buying. If you tried to buy this property right now, it would cost three times more. You're already going to be saving 50 to 60% building it. If you try to save even more, that's just plain greed. And you are going to get a nightmare, a bucket full of bad nightmares. So I just caution you, but I'm just letting everybody know, I didn't say this. Meredith said this. She doesn't work for us.
Yeah, I'm not legally allowed to take or give referral fees, so I have no financial relationships with any contractors. The other thing to think about is you get what you pay for, and you got to look at that little ADU unit in the back. You got to fix it up. So if it's not built right, you've got a problem for the rest of the time you live there. And let's go back to, let's say $100,000 is $500 per month. Let's move the decimal point. Let's say you hear, well, to do what you want to do, it's going to be $10,000 more. Okay, that's $50 a month. $10,000 is $50 a month. Really? You know, that's worth it. That's the kind of thing that's worth it and that your renter will more than pay for. How do you find out what units pay for? Well, first of all, stop going to Rent-A-Meter, stop going to Zumper and all the apartment sites. Apartments are a different product. You want the easiest way to do it is to go on Zillow, look up your property and look in your neighborhood for rentals, and then opt out of apartments and select bedroom numbers. What's the average you know, ADU, those are ADUs that are renting. There's a lot more in your neighborhood than you think. And then you're going to want to optimize for design. If you have space, like I said, for a two bedroom, consider looking at a one and one bedroom duplex. The other benefit about having a one bedroom, if you have multi bedrooms, you can pretty much count on kids, you know, lots of kids running around your backyard. So those are some of the things you need to think about. We have lots of options for homeowners. We can certainly do cash out refinances, but most people don't want to refinance. So we have HELOCs based on current value, and we have this amazing new construction HELOC. We can get you qualified up to 125% of future rental income, future value, and we can factor in the future rental income, okay, you know, to get you qualified.
Can we just talk on this for a second? Because I know this product is brand spanking new. We've been waiting. Here it is. So let me just kind of drill down on this to make sure that my team understands. So when you say 125% of future value, so let's assume that we are going to build an ADU, and let's just say it's going to be 200,000. Okay, mm-hmm. It's going to be 200,000. So you're saying that we can borrow against the future value as if it were completed.
Yes.
One year down the road, even though the equity may not be there now, you're saying we don't need the equity because the banks know that it's a no-brainer. This will pay off like a slot machine and it'll be fine.
Yep. I have clients that have just bought a home with 3% down, and we are using this construction HELOC to build an ADU and convert the garage into a room addition so that they can have future rental income. Absolutely.
Now, the interest only, I want to make sure that my team understands this as well as the attendees tonight. An interest-only loan sounds to me like it's a temporary loan. This is not a long-term loan. It's not intended to be long. It's intended to have the lowest possible monthly payment, period.
Yes, during the construction phase. In about 60% of my clients, we end up giving a complimentary, meaning we waive our lender fees, refinance, particularly when construction's down and rates are back low again. Remember, if we're, rates are coming back down again, and we want to fix that interest rate for that nice low 30-year fixed rate when we're done.
So assuming if rates are normalizing, which everything's going down in price. Gas is even going down in price. The only thing that doesn't seem to be going down on price is groceries or eggs. But everything else is going down, right?
Yeah, very much so.
Right. And so if we anticipate this time next year, we might be in good shape to do a refi then. That would be timing it perfect because the construction will be finishing, wouldn't it?
Yeah, exactly. And we don't have to refinance the entire first mortgage. We can simply fix the HELOC into a second mortgage, a fixed rate second mortgage. So again, you do not have to refinance your first mortgage.
So it's important that everybody understand, for people that have a low rate now, they do not want to mess with. This is the product they would do to finance their ADU. And once it's built, the tenant moves in and they're making a big old pile of money every month, which will now pay or offset their existing mortgage.
Absolutely. And you can do similar things with rental properties. In addition to the cash out refinances, we have a home equity loan based on 85% of current value. And we have stuff for professional investors, construction bridge loans. Newbies can use this loan. I've used this loan. These are great. The same product that my professional fix and flippers use, but it's available to you. And it's interest only for the whole duration. So the bottom line is we're going to come up with numbers like this. And this is important because especially with the ADU grant on pause, and I'll talk about that next, if the ADU grant doesn't continue, really, if you spend, typically we see $15,000 with ADU Resource Center, which is a good price on this example for designs and permits. If you spend $15,000 on a HELOC, it's $87 a month. In 2 months, that'll probably be down to $70 a month. And then it'll probably be down to, ultimately it'll be down to $45 a month. So, and then you're going to, and then later on, we're going to fix that interest rate so you can start to see the cash flow. This is a great example, but we personalize these estimates to every single person. So Everybody knows what their number is each and every month. You know what your budget is, your construction budget is, and we collaborate upfront before you spend a dime. The ADU grant is currently on pause. Frankly, it was a pain in the tush. It's $40,000. It's taxable. You got to put your entire loan amount for construction oversight. If they do it again, we did finance 90% of those grants last year. So my clients go to the front of the line, but we're working on some new options and opportunity. My recommendation is, you know, getting the grant is like winning the lottery. It's like one in a million. If you get it, awesome, but don't let it stop you. Because again, with the HELOC, you spend $10,000 on designs, it's like $50 to $80 a month.
Right.
The process is collaborative and simultaneous, and this is important. So this is where you are right now. Over time, those rates are going to come down. So if you think about it, this is perfect timing to start an ADU, and we collaborate together in lockstep to basically walk you through that program. That's our job. And so again, I would recommend you know, these recommendations, do not run out of cash. Have all of your money ready to go up front. The black hole of lending is a half-baked, half-built ADU. I had one client that had trouble getting approved, so she put it all on credit cards, and she's now heading into bankruptcy. So we need to know all of this up front so that you have a clean, clear, awesome ADU, not just physically, but financially. This is making sense.
You know, Meredith, we tell our clients to put a little, you know, a little something, something in the kitty for a rainy day, just maybe an extra 10%. So whatever we think the budget would be,
yep,
it would be wise to put a little bit extra. If you don't use it, you don't use it, but it should something come up. And what I think comes up a lot is in during design, which I'm going to talk about in a second. When we get to the design phase, that's fun. I mean, people start saying, hey, can I add this? Can I do that? Can I do that? Mm-hmm. I think you should. I think you should build it with love and do exactly what you want. It's your most precious asset is our home. And you are doing an expansion of your home. Yep. And you're adding additional square foot. Get everything in the project that you want to do. For every dollar you spend on the ADU, it'll pay you back three. So what's the risk?
Yeah,
put a little bit extra aside so that you can say yes to your great ideas through design.
Also, I want to add to my construction loans from Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, they require me to add a 10% contingency buffer. And during that inflationary period, that was incredibly helpful. My clients pretty much did not go into pocket. But also, you're going to have guys stomping through your yard. You're doing this big loan. Fix up the house. Add a pool. You know, there's so much. Master plan your property into what you want to build, for sure.
Okay. Is that it?
That's it for me.
Come on, there's more, isn't there?
We'll get into SB9 another time, but yeah.
All right. So stick around. I'm going to go into the design stuff now. If you have questions, you can click on the chat screen. We'll answer some of them tonight. We're already going to be running short on time. Every question you have is important. We want to make sure that we address every single question that you have. So if we can't get to it tonight, we're going to address it tomorrow when the customer care units are working the phones and calling everybody saying, how can we help? And what was your question? So we'll get to everybody, I promise. Let me see if I can share a new screen. Okay. So if you see that you have a green light, in other words, the project is feasible, the scope of work makes sense, you've got it figured out what shape is going to work best out there, we've walked the property, we've put flags in the ground, we see it, we visualize it, and everything's wonderful, and we may be scheduled an appointment with Meredith or someone like her, but probably Meredith, and said, hey, looks like I can do this. What's the first thing that we should do? So the first thing I think that we should do is we should try to figure out a floor plan. And so a floor plan is the design, and the design concept basically is the personality of the ADU. So what we would like to do is we'll take anything, even if it's on a cocktail napkin. If you're sketching around with some cartoons or something that you think is cool, that's great. If not, we have our own set of templates that we'll share with you, and we have some things that we can edit, but everything on our templates are to be determined. So walls and windows and all that stuff could be pushed around to make it personalized for your ADU. At some point in time, what we're working towards is putting a shovel in the ground and getting started. Every city has one condition. I need a building permit before I can do any construction in anybody's backyard. And what they say is that don't tell me, show me. So we have to build four sets of architectural plans that we provide to the city so they can examine them and say, okay, I give you permission to do what you want to do. It starts with the architectural design set. That's basically going to be a plot plan, an overview of your property. We're going to place the ADU smack down where we say we're going to put it. And all this has to be done to scale. So this says what we are going to build. The architectural or the structural engineering says, how are you going to build it? Show me the elevations. Show me the 3D renderings. Let's see what this thing's going to look like. Is it going to match the main house or look like an eyesore? The structural engineering is very, very comprehensive. It's going to give a building materials list of how many screws, how many boards, all that sort of thing. California, we're a green state. So they say, look, how many BTUs is it going to take to heat and cool this new ADU? Because we're green, we want to conserve energy, as you know. So we have to provide the energy calculations for the ADU. And if it meets their requirements, great. If it doesn't, we may have to add more insulation or deduct some windows or shrink the sides of the windows or change the location of the windows. If you put too big of windows on the east and west sides of the ADU where the solar path of the sun heats up the house, they may say, can you move them to the north and south? And we can keep that house from heating up too much, things like that. The last set is also for California, and it's called a low impact development plan set or an LID. And they say, hey, it rained hard last week. That water that rained down, where's that water gonna go once it hits the ADU? Well, it's gonna go down the gutter and down the sewer. No, it's not. It's gotta go into a water catching system and into barrels, and it's gotta be dispersed cleverly to the flowers and shrubs or lawn. So these are the four sets of plans that are required, and they are comprehensive and they are very, very complex. And this is not something that you want a shortcut on. These four sets of plans are going to determine the success or failure of your project. When they are all done, you can print them out like we do, and they are rolled up and they're as big as a basketball. This is what we have to take down to the city, and this is what they're going to inspect. So the next question is, why does it take so long once we drop them off to the city? Because it does take several months. How long will this take? Well, the project's going to be a while. I think it's clear to say if we are now in February, it could take, it's been averaging 6 to 7 months for architectural plans, and most projects are 4 to 5 months. So let's just say that the completion is probably going to be 2024, maybe not 2023, but maybe. We're finding that Mayor Bass for LA is very, very aggressive. And she says she swears she is going to have plans done in 60 days and we'll all look like heroes. I think we may even be lucky. We're starting to see signs. What's the fastest we got done so far?
Less than a month.
Three weeks. I mean, that's unheard of. That's absolutely unheard of. And this is during COVID when they were taking a year. So maybe we are making some progress. Fingers crossed on that. I don't want to say that your project will be done in 3 weeks, but I'm hopeful that it'll be better. So it could be 2023. Or it could be 2024. I know LA County is slower than LA City, but here's kind of the overview of what it looks like. You know, let's say we started designing. One of the things that we'd like to do is put sort of a finish line on what we want to try to do. Let me move this thing out of my way so I can straighten this out. Okay. So let's say today we start the plans I would say that within 3 weeks, I'd sure like to have a floor plan established. So this is going to require your help. You're going to have to work with us and figure out what we are going to do with the shape and size that you decide. After that, I would say if we have a floor plan concept figured out within 3 weeks' time, we are on schedule. From there, I need to make the architectural plan set, structural engineering set, Title 24, and now the new LID plan set. So four sets of plans. I would like to say that within 2 months from the start date, if we can have that done, we are then on schedule and ready to submit to the city. Once we submit to the city, this is what takes the time. This is what takes a little bit of time. We submit it, and it doesn't mean they wait on us right away. It goes into a holding bin. We wait our turn. And so what we want to do is find something to do. So get a pillow and a blanket and settle in, because it's going to be a while. When they eventually get to us, we will start paying our city fees, and they'll start working on the plan check. They'll eventually say, hey, okay, we look this over. We'd like you to make a couple of revisions, and then get them back to us, and you should be good to go. This is very customary, very ordinary. We resubmit them back to the city, and now we're waiting for the big RTI or ready to issue. And once they say it's ready to issue, this is when we want to start mobilizing and start meeting with our construction team, who's been waiting patiently. By the way, our construction team has been planning, working out the design concept with the designers over here. So they work in tandem, and they are so familiar with their project that they are ready to mobilize and start ordering building materials and hitting the ground running. When it's time to go pick up the plans and the permit, the construction team has already done a video call with you, and we've already discussed that what needs to happen. Does your garage need to be cleaned out? Are you prepared? Have you got your money set aside? Great, so that we can start planning the green light for the construction, okay? A word on our construction and on our design team. ADU
reach- center the frames when you're showing them?
Yeah. Let me make it bigger. ADU Resource is unlike any other company out there right now. So we saw an opportunity to try to make the experience as positive as possible. We have 10 architect designers on staff to work on the project for you. At the end of tonight's show, you're going to see a video, and you'll see the design. You'll see a tour of our office and the design team working. So they're going to be working on the design sets for you, but we have 25 licensed general contractors to choose from. So we have four that work internally, and then we have 21 that we've already triple vetted. And so we screened maybe 75 contractors, and only 21 sort of fit the grade, right, Shara?
Yep.
Because they're representing us at some point in time with 300 projects, we're going to need some helping hands. What we don't want to do is have you wait for the project going through the planning department. And then all of a sudden, when it's time to start, you say, when can we start? Well, we're backed up. You're going to have to wait another 6 months. We don't want to do that. So we're already prepared that we've got helping hands ready to go. Our internal contractors are going to work on them first, but we have 25 to choose from, ranging from every price under the sun. So we're going to be doing the shopping aggressively for you, so you don't have to feel compelled. You have to go on Google and guess and interview people. We're going to help you with that process and make sure we get the most aggressive price and a contractor that's local to you, that's not driving too many miles away, that's going to be late every day, okay? So what do we include in your project? Generally, what we'd like to do is do a turnkey proposal or recommendation. So what we would say is, look, most contractors are not going to include the appliances. They're going to say that's a personal thing, but I think you should still budget for it. So we may say, hey, put a couple of $1,000 if you're just doing a range, a refrigerator, and a microwave. But if you're going to add a washer and dryer, let's just say add $4,000 roughly to your proposal, so that you know in your mind you've accounted for everything. Otherwise, our recommendation is going to be turnkey, so that everything is going to be included in there, so you don't have to worry about anything. The project is a great investment. It's important to remember that you're not buying anything, you're reinvesting in your own property. which will pay for itself three times over once it's complete. How do we know this? Try to go buy one right now that's already built, and you'll spend three times what you're going to spend building your ADU. The equity growth in your property will buy the ADU, not the hard-earned cash. Let the dirt under the house buy and pay for your ADU. If you finance it, the tenant is going to be paying the entire monthly payment for the ADU, not you. And in nearly every situation, not only is the payment for the ADU covered, but there's leftover cash for you. So you're going to have a fun time doing that. I don't want to go deep into this because I want to start getting to some questions, but I do want to talk that we can do second story conversions. It does require some things that I should probably point out. Let me just, okay. So this is underpinning. So when you're doing a second story, let's say you got a garage and somebody says, well, I just want to put an ADU on top of it. Well, that's good, but we can't do that because the garage was not intended for the weight of that second story that's going to go up there. So we now need to reinforce the perimeter of the garage or the lower structure if it's your main house. And we need to put in new footings, okay? So all of this has to be rebarred in cement, as you can see. And then we have to have cement footings in it so the thing doesn't tilt, it doesn't list and tip over, okay, or collapse. With that being said, the framing of the lower structure is probably built with 2x4s. That's not good enough for a second story. It requires 4x4s. So they're not going to take these down. What they're going to do is put them next to the 2x4s and strengthen the length. So if you take a 4x4 and you stand it on end like that, it's very, very strong, and it's going to help support the weight of the second story, and that'll prevent these from collapsing, okay? The other thing that is important to know about second story projects, it is hazardous work. They have to build a staircase to get building materials up to the top floor to work on, whether it's the permanent one or a temporary one. In almost every case, there'll be scaffolding, and it's very hazardous work because this is how contractors fall off and get injured. So it's a little bit expensive, and their insurance is more expensive, I'm sure, on second story projects. If you are doing an ADU over your main house, be advised, we have to do underpinning on the lower structure. If that lower structure is part of your main house and it's a kitchen, your kitchen is going to be in a construction zone too. So you want to be mindful of where you put your ADU. Otherwise, during the entire construction of the second stage or second floor, that lower level has to be gutted and reinforced, and you may not like it for the duration. You might be displaced. We want to always make sure that the city allows for a second story. We want to make sure we're mindful of power lines and whatever is going to be in the way of the demolition down below. I think I want to stop there because we're running long, and I want to just see if you guys saw, there's a couple of things on here. We have, if you know you want to schedule a video call with us, you can click on it, or you can wait for us to call you tomorrow, whatever you like. But I want to share something with you that is new, and we have a rare thing that's coming up, and that's going to be open house. So a lot of our clients are saying, hey, is there any chance we can see one? Yes, but it's tough. And so here's the deal. We don't always get to pick when that happens because when the ADU is done, you can imagine someone's going in there, and if it's a tenant, then they are going to want to start making their money because they've been a while, so they want to make something. So what we have to do is try to ask the homeowners, can we show it about 80% done before it's done, so we don't disrupt them having a family member move in or a tenant. So this is well before they're even allowed to. So we'll try to get a weekend or two. It's usually on Saturdays, but I want to show you a couple of ADUs that are going to be coming up soon. This is a studio. This was a one-car garage in Los Angeles. It was a one-car garage, and they expanded it out the back a little bit, and they vaulted the ceiling. And in order to vault the ceiling, sometimes we have to put a beam in there or a load-bearing wall. Well, they didn't want a load-bearing wall because it's a studio. The whole idea of it as a studio is no walls. So the only wall in there is for the bathroom. But the beam is there to support the vault. And it's a pretty cool little ADU, I got to admit. It's a very vintage style. It's got subway tile. It's got sort of lacquer cabinets with quartz countertops. It's industrial, so it's got a cement floor, which is kind of a new deal out right now. It's a new trend that are people kind of liking. In this case, they put not only a vault, but they put a skylight in there. It looks pretty slick, and it's on a remote control. But as you can see, by not having a wall inside there, it's an open concept studio floor plan, but it makes it feel open. It's very, very inviting when you walk in. And the bed is not a big deal at all. So I think that if you're thinking, I have under 400 square foot, well, imagine that your ADU could look like this. This is not a bad day. They put little barn doors for the closet organizers in there. That's kind of cute, right? So the second ADU that's going to be coming available, we have a detached in Long Beach, and it's 800 square feet. It's two bedroom, two bath. And what I like about this product is it's basic. So imagine that we have three tiers: basic, middle, and then Highline. By default, ADU Resource, we're middle of the road, unless they tell us. In this case, they told us we want to go basic, but we want to add maybe one or two things as upgrades, but we don't want the entire project middle. We want to go as affordable as we can. So what they did was they went pretty basic with all the appliances, as we'll show you, but what they did upgrade, he says, look, I want to go 10 foot on a raised ceiling. I don't want to go vault. I want to go a raised ceiling with skylight and recessed lighting. So pretty cool. The skylight and the raised ceiling makes it look massive, and it's not that big. But as you can see from the appliances, they're not real fancy. I mean, you can go to Home Depot and Lowe's, and you can probably buy this stuff for less than $2,000. He went this route with everything, including the bathroom. Washer and dryer, walk-in pantry. This is a great way to control the budget of your project without overspending. He did say, look, I don't want to go linoleum. I do want to go vinyl planked flooring. That's the tongue and groove stuff that looks like hardwood. It looks just like hardwood, but you don't have to finish it or stain it or maintenance or sand it. So it's the floor of choice. So really the only thing they added as an upgrade was the raised ceiling and the flooring and the skylight. Everything else, as you will see, they did put tile, but look at the finishes on the toilet and the sink. I mean, this is basic stuff you can buy at Lowe's. They said, look, we want to put porcelain tile in the sink. We want a tiled shower pan. Great. If you were going to put money anywhere, this is where you would do it, is in the bathroom or possibly in the kitchen. Okay. But as you can see, I mean, this is pretty basic stuff, but it's functional. It may not be fashionable. The idea of looking at this project is not necessarily to say, I want mine like that, but it's going to influence the finishes that you think you want to do on yours, which could help narrow down your choices. Sometimes we need to see too much or too little to know what we want. This is a pretty big room. It's 15 by 12. So this is the master bedroom. There's a big master. There's the HVAC system right up there and the big ceiling in there. I mean, the thing looks like a vault. He did put big windows in here, so he has a lot of natural daylight and sunlight in there. The second bathroom is interesting because this is what it would look like if you said, I want to do a tub and shower head combo. Now, I don't know that I would have put a shower enclosure on a tub. I think I like to have my arm hang over the side when I'm in the tub, and maybe having a shower stall there prohibits me from doing that. Maybe one of those warped bars on a shower curtain sticking out a little bit would be a better choice, but that's just me. He did finish this off with the same porcelain tile. Looks great. But as you can see, the rest of the bathroom, pretty basic stuff. I mean, it's not even a frame on the mirror, but this is how he controlled his costs. He said, I want a basic unit and I'll put maybe one or two or three upgrades so I can control the overall project. And it looks great. This is what the water catching system looks like. So as the roof has what we call a gable like that, there's one on each side and they go into these barrels. And then there's a little spout, little spigot right there. You can determine where is that water going to go to. So once the project is done, they're going to start doing the landscaping. And I think he's probably going to put rock back here. And then, so this will probably be a set it and forget it or a maintenance free backyard. Here's a look at the main unit or the HVAC system. There's three independent head units on the wall in there. So he went a little bit larger on this so they wouldn't have to put three separate compressors outside. We use one in a ducting system. And this is what hot water systems look like nowadays. They're not using that old fashioned big round drum anymore. So this is a tankless water system, but I like to call it endless water. So if Sean over here took a half hour shower, and then Mike C took a half hour shower, and then I took a half hour shower, we could still get three more people behind us. And everybody, as long as the water goes through the system, everybody has hot water. So it's endless hot water. And this is just the technology that we're using in ADUs nowadays, and ultimately going in main houses too. Now, that was the Long Beach project. This is in Encino in San Fernando Valley. Believe it or not, this was a one-car garage right there. And they wanted to expand in front of it, and they wanted to expand behind it. But they wanted to use some setbacks. So these are what the setbacks looks when they jog it out to make it a little bit wider. You can see a better look at it right there, okay? On the side of the house, when they expand it, if you have a property that's built on the property line like this one was, the extension has to acknowledge that we have to adhere to that 4-foot setback. And people go, oh, that's going to look terrible inside. No, it's not. It creates angles. It creates really neat decorating opportunities on the inside. And it creates options for doors like this and storage for bicycles, gardening equipment, and anything else we want out of way that we're not looking at. On the entry side, you can see this is where the front expansion was. This is where they chose to put the front door during that set for that setback. So it actually worked out really, really good. So going inside, they went a different direction. They didn't raise the walls, they vaulted the ceiling. So this is definitely middle of the road. We're using shaker style cabinets. I like the seafoam green backsplash back there. It looks very, very vintage. Shaker style cabinets and full size appliances. Lots of drawers everywhere. This is a great concept, but I mean, they put not one, not two, not three, but four skylights in there. And it just looks dramatic when you walk in. So there's two ways you can kind of create ambiance in the ADU, or at least in the common area. And that is to either raise the ceiling to 9 or possibly 10 feet, like the Long Beach or like on this Encino project, they vaulted it. Okay. There's the skylights. I mean, it's glorious. When you're standing in there, you can just go, wow, this is pretty slick. I'd love to do that for mine. If your project is big enough, we always recommend make a dedicated laundry area that's out of the way. Don't need to have it in the kitchen. Although sometimes there's no more space. If that's the case, our design team is pretty talented. They'll figure out a good home for this, and we can even enclose this. Here's the master bedroom, and you can see they're going to have a courtyard out there. So they wanted a slider patio going out there. They already know what they want to do with them. They're going to make a tranquility corner out there so that they have access to go out there. Again, even the bedrooms, this is unusual. Most people don't vault bedrooms and bathrooms. They only vault the common area, which is the living room and the kitchen, but they did on this and it looks glorious. It looks fantastic. Now on this bathroom, they had a particular look. They wanted to be contemporary. They didn't need a big vanity. They did use a heavy frameless shower stall with tile, and it looks really, really smart. On the guest bath, they went with a framed shower with partial tile. But again, you can see the appliances or the bathroom fixtures, nothing super fancy. There, you don't need to go broke spending a lot of money on these things, and it's it's still going to turn out fabulous. So again, we have these coming soon. They're by appointment because it's private property. So as we call some of you tomorrow, if any of you are interested in looking at some, we'll figure out what they're going to be, when they'll be available. The owners sometimes let us go back-to-back weekends. Sometimes they say, not this weekend, we have house guests coming. So typically from Saturdays between 9 and 2 p.m., and again, it's by appointment, and for COVID reasons, we don't want to stack too many people and have you all out there. So that's about all I want to talk about tonight. Does anybody have any questions that you want to ask us before we go? I am going to call, our customer care division will be working from 9 o'clock tomorrow in the morning till noon. And we have the registration log. We're going to try to call everyone. So write down anything that you want us to talk about. We don't need to talk about it now in public. We can talk about it in private if you like. If you're not going to be available tomorrow, but you still want us to call, just send us an email at info@aduresourcecenter.com and tell us what your preferred schedule is. If you're working days and you prefer evenings or weekends, what's that?
Or that there's a link in the chat. Schedule an appointment.
Oh, I forgot. There's a couple of links in the chat. Meredith, did you post yours?
She did.
So Meredith has posted a chat. So here's what we're figuring out. The old days of saying, call me, those are gone. Everybody's busy. So the best way to do it is the courtesy calendars I love, because it says, you pick a day, you pick a time, that is your day, that is your time, and someone will talk to you for sure, including us and including Meredith. So if you want to click on any of these calendars and make an appointment, it's super simple, super easy, and it's guaranteed. I have probably...
You're going to walk away with a plan, like a real action plan and next steps. That's what's exciting about it.
Yeah. So Tia Campbell, you had your hand up. What can I do for you?
I don't think they're allowed to.
Are we allowed to? Can we unmute them, Vic?
Or we can open up chat.
Hi there. Quick question. Would you mind showing the first ADU one more time? Just the photo of it again.
Of the studio in LA?
Correct.
For 50 cents, I will.
You know, I had a question about that, Danny, because it's interesting. I'm a big fan in terms of cost cutting, of using the cement floors. I think it's really ultra modern. Most of my rental investors are not adding carpet because of allergy and health reasons. And so the cement is really cool. And then if the renters want to have carpets, fine, they can bring in carpets. But the other benefit too is that couldn't you bring the cement floor into the bathroom and then just put like a shower in the bathroom and just slope it down without having to pay for any tile other than the wall?
Yeah, piece of cake, easy stuff. Here's the thing, I'll tell you, the cement floor, or the, we'll call it the industrial look, because it even goes as far as showing HVAC ventilation up, kind of like you would see in the Home Depot or big warehouse or Costco or something like that. And it's becoming more and more trendy with executive offices. I mean, that's how they're decorating them now. And old people hate them. Young people love them. So I know how old you are, depending upon if you like it or hate it. But so this is what it looks like. And so, Tia, is this what you wanted me to show? She's still there?
Yeah. I wanted to say one more thing about those concrete floors. So most likely the floor in your garage, it's probably yucky. You got some grease stains in there, oil stains, cracks. And that's not the floor that we're using. We're pouring a layer of fresh concrete on top of that and then putting a clear coat that's a very non-porous clear coat that's going to prevent future stains on there. So we're creating that beautiful look. But it's not your existing garage.
Right. So even if the dog pees on it, you know, the renters or whatever, they spill wine or whatever, you're not going to have a problem like you would with carpet or something else.
Right.
Yeah.
Vic, can you unmute Arkin, please? He's got his hand up.
Let me see if I can do it.
Or or actually unmute Tia first, because I think she would, I want to make sure I ask, address her question. Tia Campbell.
Okay, so we have our team.
Tia wanted, yeah, she had, she was first. She had a question.
Okay.
Do you see her?
Yeah, thank you. So somehow I got muted again, so I couldn't talk to you while you were talking. So yeah, this is exactly what I wanted to know. But in terms of these, do how often do you see radiant heating for the flooring when you're having the cement in ADUs, if at all?
I don't know that we are going to see much at all on the West Coast. And here's the thing, it's a Midwest and East Coast thing. Because of the climate, obviously, right? And we don't have the temperature swing on the West Coast that they do in the Midwest. Even though, I mean, in the Midwest,
I understand. I just said sometimes when you have that concrete, it is really cold. You know, it is a very cold thing. So you got to definitely like put down rugs or something. So,
yeah. Area rugs are always a wise idea. I to me, and this is just me, I don't know that you could, you know, extrapolate or justify radiant heating in a cement floor. I don't know that we would want to do a cement floor if you're concerned about heating. There's much better options. That would not be one of them.
Right. That would be very similar to a tile floor. Is also going to have a similar temperature to it. And I do agree, area rugs, great choice. If you really want to have radiant heating in there, we can do it.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Yeah. Artin was next.
Hi, guys. I actually recently met with your team, and I'm very pleased with the whole setup that you guys have. On the second ADU that you shared, the one with the high ceiling, do you mind sharing the cost for the entire project?
You know, I don't mind at all if I can get a straight answer out of the guy. He wasn't very forthcoming with me. So I asked him the other day. I was there on Saturday, and he didn't say specifically what it was, but I'm thinking it was in the low 200,000s.
Well, we can find out. I mean, we have the numbers, but we just have to look it up. And Artin, I met with you personally, so I can share that with you when I meet you next time.
Yeah. Do you know the cost of the first one?
I don't have
it.
Or a roundabout estimate?
Yeah, it's 377 square feet. I think it was like 145, 150-ish like that, but it was done last year. So it sort of depends. Remember, that one was tricky because it was a one-car garage. They expanded fore and aft, and then they put in a solid beam for the vault, right?
Can you go back to the photo again one more time? I mean, there you skipped a few before. Not the third, like we've already seen those two first two, but like past that, yeah, right there. Okay.
Yeah. And the other thing I don't know that we are able to see here, we have videos of this product, but it's right on pool. I mean, it's really close to a pool. So there was some tricky engineering on this thing because we had to make sure that we didn't damage or disrupt the integrity of the swimming pool, obviously, right? But I really love this look right here. So it's sort of a shed roof because it comes down unusually low. It's actually slightly lower than what other people would be because this is not exactly 8 feet. I think it's 7.
Yeah, that's a little bit low.
You know,
was there a picture of the bathroom on that one?
There's not on this presentation. No.
Okay.
You know what? We have one though. So if you
schedule
a meeting with us and ask us,
I have a video that shows the bathroom. It's glorious.
It is? Okay.
Yes, yeah, breathtaking. Because it's all tile.
It doesn't look like a one-car garage. It looks bigger.
It does, doesn't it?
It was expanded.
It expanded.
Oh, it was expanded. Okay, great. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Artin, did we get your questions? Everything good on that? Okay. Chris Aros, Vic. Patiently holding his arm. His arm's tired. I've been holding it up for an hour.
Hello.
Hi, Chris.
Hi. For a property in the San Fernando Valley, are there pre-approved city plans for an attached garage?
Mike is better to go with that. So pre-approved plans. Yes, there are pre-approved plans, but those pre-approved plans don't mean that you get to just take those plans and say, okay, build this. There's a lot that has to be done with those plans in order for them to be ready for permit. What we're going to have to do is make sure that that plan suits your property, ideally. It has to follow within the zoning of your property, not just in general. We're also going to have to take a look at your use case, because that plan might be great, but you know what? You might have left 2 or 3 feet off the table that simply modifying that could have been the way to go. Now, once all that's done, those pre-approved plans, they have to be engineered for your specific soil types in your area. They're going to have to go through engineering, planning, and the same process to go through the city. They don't really save that much time, and the amount of adjustments that we generally have to do don't really save that much money. They're a great step for putting together an idea of what you like and getting us to a floor plan, a design that suits your needs, and then we can detail it out and send it through the city and get this project rolling for you.
Now, having that said, if you find a plan that you like and it works out perfectly on your property for whatever reason, we can still move forward with that.
Here's picking up with that. The most important thing about the pre-approved plans that I want everybody to understand, they exist. Now, we've submitted our plans to the city to get on that long waiting list of approved, pre-approved plans. And eventually they'll get to us and we'll get our stuff up there. But it's something to remember. The whole notion of this is to try to fast track it through the city, correct? So if we're looking at pre-approved plans, the idea is, oh, my project is going to get approved quicker. Yes and no. You cannot move one thing in the pre-approved plans. If you said, hey, can I change the window? Yeah, but it's no longer fast track. Can I change the door? Can I add this? Can I raise the ceiling? Can I vote? You can't do anything. So those have to stay cookie cutter for them to be so-called fast track. If we modify them, we get in the back of the line like everybody else. Now, let's think about this and let's be sensible. If you're building an ADU and you're told you can't do this, you can't do that, you got to take what it's a cookie cutter, there it is, there's the floor plan, you want to take it, go. I don't know that that's going to work, because it's your home, it's your house. You're going to have an opinion on what the thing looks like. I don't think taking a front seat in the line is more important than the right design. So what I would caution you is be careful about what you ask for. If you get it, and you want to change something, yes, we can change it, but we go to the end of the line. It's no longer fast track.
You know what? I'm going to take a different approach on this. You guys have had so many ADUs approved in the cities around in the LA area. It's more about rapport. It's more about walking up to the counter and saying, hey, Bob, you know, how you doing, man? You know, I got another one. It's just like the one we just did on a main street, but we changed this and this. That rapport, that credibility is going to get you so much further. They already have the design. So it's not about the LA pre-approved designs. It's about designs that have already been pre-approved and the rapport that, you know, you guys have with the cities, all of the cities. So,
let's imagine at one time we were strangers. We're not anymore. They see us a lot, right? We're down there. So I can't say we're drinking buddies. We don't necessarily golf together, but they can be bribed. And so we do our best. And we know that women like chocolate and guys like booze. So sometimes packages show up to help things, the doors open up. Yes, we do all of that stuff. Of course we do. But I would say that, look, if you want to build a project that I'll just tell you right now, I've never had a customer yet say, well, now that it's all done, we've gone through this project, are you happy the way it turned out? And I've never heard a customer say, you know, Dan, it's too nice for us. We don't deserve it. It's too spacious. We've got all this room. We wish we made it smaller and more cramped. I've never heard anybody say that. But what I have heard clients say is, you know, we gave ourselves a budget. We said, let's not go over this number. And so we stuck with that number. And no matter how many ideas we had during design, we said, no, Remember, we promised each other. You're right. All right. And so the design stayed the way it stayed. The building material stayed exactly under budget or at budget, no more. And when it's all said and done, I said, well, if you did anything over, would you change anything? They go, yeah, we would have gotten our ideas. We would have done what we wanted. Our instincts were right. Our plan to stay within budget was wrong. And so what I would caution you is you don't have to stick to a cement. It's not in stone, okay? You should be a willow tree, not an oak tree. Flex and flow. As you're going through the design stage, your budget will grow. That's okay, because if the design is better than when we started and the project comes out and it exceeds your expectations, it's worth every dime. Okay, that means we did it right. If we let you spend exactly what you said and it comes out and you say it's okay, we didn't do it right. We messed up. Okay. Did we get, I don't know who was raising their hands. Vic, did we see anybody else up there?
We have Artin.
Artin we spoke to.
You guys can post questions in the chat room too if you're not very social.
I got one more question, but by the way, the chat is disabled, so you may want to the chat room is disabled. You can't type questions.
We got to have an IT guy.
Question, at what point we are going to be talking about the finished material such as tile, I don't know, faucets, vanities, are these part of the construction paperwork that you guys will give it to us?
I'm going to give you an easier way to do it, because in the beginning there are things, let's just call them stages or milestones is the correct terminology for it. But in the beginning, the design concepts are more important than the finishes. However, what I would say that everyone on this call should start doing is maintaining a Pinterest folder of images, gallery images. So imagine that you start snooping around the internet, because you guys are all snoopers. I know you are. So start saving images of kitchens, bedrooms, bathrooms, anything that you think is super cool. And then share that folder with us at some point in time, because what that's going to do is that's going to show us the bullseye. If we know where the bullseye is, we'll hit it. What I'd like everybody to do is say, look, there's a time and a place. In the beginning in the design, it's not so much important that you start figuring out your finishes. We're going to get to that as we get closer to the construction, absolutely. But in the beginning, I think there's a lot more important decisions to be made in the design. Meanwhile, what you can do if you've got the time and the interest, start saving images to a folder. And if you can save it, for example, on a Google Drive and send us the copy of the link, our construction team could look at it. So what I like to do, this is just what we recommend. We like to address the budget three times, okay? In the beginning, we're all guessing. We don't know, because you haven't designed anything yet. But we're going to try to give you a scope of work and a roundabout budget of what we think your project should cost. If you're in agreement with that, we move forward and start designing. When you get out of designing, we want to see that design again, because you probably grew it. I hope you did. And if you did, we need to make sure that the price adjustment is okay with you. You're going to approve it. If it is, we move forward. If it's not, we have to take that design and put it back to where we started, or something's got to give if that's what you want us to do. We'll look at that pricing a second time when we come out of design. If everything is still a go, because you said, I know it went up because I got my ideas in there. Those are my ideas. I want them. Beautiful. Perfect. We'll keep them. That third time we look at it is during RTI, or ready to issue, when we're about 30 to 45 days away from construction. It may have been several months. We don't know if the supply chain or inflation or anything, it may be Putin hit the missile button and we're in war. We don't know what's going on, but it would be irresponsible not to look at the pricing a third time at that stage to make sure that there's no surprises. So we like to look at it three times, okay? Looks like the chat room is loading up with questions. All right, so let's see what we got. Let me go up to the top. How much does home insurance and real estate taxes go up because of the ADU, say 1200 square foot separate structure? So each city has their own different ordinance and a tax structure, but let's remember one thing. the main house is not affected. It's only the improvements, right? But I don't want to answer that specifically. And I would rather deal with that, Mubina, with a private question, because we'd like to know a little bit more. We could find that out. So rather than me guess right now and give a general answer, it's a lot easier to just find out what city. So
I can answer that, Danny.
Yeah.
So the tax assessor will, you can call your county tax assessor. They typically tell you to, so the current, it's a blended rate. Your current house and the land, which the land is the most expensive part, they stay at the current rate that you're at. So you're fine there. The new ADU is supposedly charged at the new tax rate, just the square footage on the ADU. They will tell you to multiply 1% times the construction budget, but I don't usually see it that high. I typically see about $100 a month. The insurance is about 20%. Do not insure the ADU separately. It's just part of the regular homeowner's insurance. It's $20. So it's really not that expensive at all.
Okay, thank you. Gary and Brandy asked, does the feet away from the building include a shed? Could be, but I don't know. If the shed is already up, may be a problem. If the shed mysteriously appears after the last building inspection, then no. On the average, what will the ADU cost per square foot? This is the best question, because this is what everybody wants to know. So let's take a look at let's look at it regionally. So if you live in the LA, we don't want a contractor driving from Fontana or San Bernardino, because they're going to be stuck in traffic. So let's just take a circle, what I call a circle of sensibility. And so it's within a reasonable circumference around your property. Now, our network is going to cover that. So if we have them coming from a sensible distance, most of the contractors that we deal with are going to be between 250 and up as high as 400 per square foot in San Diego. In LA, it's between 250 and 300 square foot. San Diego is a little bit higher, okay? But again, when it's time for us to start shopping the construction project, we will do that for you. You don't have to go dialing for dollars and try to guess which contractor you're going to pick. Number one, I highly recommend only people with ADU experience. This hasn't been around very long. So the guys that build, you know, kitchen renovations and all that, or bathrooms and stuff, or even if they did track homes like we used to do, it's a totally different product. And if they've never done one, you do not want to be the guinea pig. So if they don't have any ADU specific experience with multiple units, that would not be the contractor that I would recommend. We vetted our own network. So we have 25 to choose from. It's doubtful that you're going to get a lower price than we can, but at some point in time, we will be happy to do the shopping for you. Distance from the building city. So that's an answer. The size of the shed will influence you. Okay, that's already done. Will the recording be, so yeah, we're going to have, you know, the recording of this will be, takes a couple of days, right, Vic, on YouTube before they populate it?
Yeah, 3 days probably.
Yeah, so in a couple of days, we'll be happy to send it out to everybody, but YouTube takes their time, and when it comes, we'll get it. Okay, so Mike's already, oh, I forgot, Mike's our credited tax guy. He knows a lot of these answers, Mike G. What sort of property tax of a unit is it going up? I think we've answered that. I want to schedule an appointment for, so Manuel, if you, you want to do an open house? Okay.
So I'd say probably the best bet for scheduling an open house, let's have a conversation with one of our specialists first, and we'll definitely invite and schedule an open house meeting for you.
Absolutely.
So I'm sharing the link. To get to an open house, you start by registering here.
Okay. What are the rules for converting an attached garage to the house? And then I don't know if that's cut off. What are the rules for converting an attached garage to the house? If I take that question the way it's written and just guess on that, there's no more there's not a missing sentence or word there. There's not rules. The only thing that we have to do is that we have to make sure that it's going to be independent from the main house. It's got to be legal. So we got to have a slab. We've got to have four walls and a ceiling. It's got to have a kitchen, a bedroom, a bathroom, and a living room. And the appliances could be piggybacked off, or the electrical and water could be piggybacked off the main house, but the sewer has to go independent. So it's got to be routed out to the front of the house. And you're probably going to want to upgrade your electrical panel, because the garage is no longer a garage. It's now a mini apartment. And so it requires its own 100 amp service. So you'll want to upgrade the main house to 200.
Yep. I want to clarify one thing on that one. It doesn't necessarily have to have a bedroom, but it does have to have a bedroom space. It can be a studio. It doesn't have to have a dedicated room for that. A kitchen will be required. A bathroom for an attached garage may share with the main house if it is classified as a junior ADU, but not if it's a standard ADU. We could get into that in detail. Please use the link and we'll schedule and talk about your project.
So Anna Salamat wrote, my house is at the corner. I don't know if Meredith already answered this one or not. My house is at the corner of the streets. If we change the garage to an ADU and plan to open the side area for a carport, can we convert the side yard to become a carport? Sure. Yeah, no problem. The primary unit. Okay, so the people are already answering a lot of these questions. Please add me to the list. Jerry, I think, Jerry, you and I are going to be scheduled to talk in a day or so. So we'll definitely chit-chat on that. Open house visits, there's a link right there. If you want to click on it, just make sure we have your name and info so we can schedule you. Again, it's private property. So there's no such thing as an open house. It's going to be a viewing, but it's a private property viewing. So we have to do it when the owner says we can be there. Our apartment is Friday, Jerry. Did I miss one? Can you convert a second story of a home to an ADU? It's getting tricky here. We're getting the tricky answers. Yes, you can. So there's such a thing called a junior ADU, and it's basically using part of the internal square footage of the house. So there are some rules that could be done, but it certainly can be done. And so what we'd want to do is maybe hop on a video call and let's take a look at the property and see what you got. And if we can probably give you a rough idea of what it would take to do so. Remember, if you're going to be converting it, we have to create a stairwell. So the stairwell is either internal or external. So those things have to be worked out. If it's internal, it could disrupt the lower level on accessing it. So we want to make sure that we measure twice, cut once, and design it correctly. Otherwise, we could have problems. But yeah, it's absolutely possible.
You know what I love about that is the idea of carving up a house, especially if you don't need as much space as you used to. And I love seeing, you know, upstairs being converted with an outside steps, and then you close in the inside steps. That's a great way to go and have good use of your existing space.
Well, assuming that you wanted them independent from the main house. So, for example, if it was going to be a rental unit, I don't know that you'd want the tenant sharing the interior steps of the main house. So this would be why we'd want to put an external staircase. But yeah, that's easy stuff. I mean, it sounds complex, but if we have room and we can do that, remember the stairwell could be encumbering these 4-foot setback. So depending upon the side of the house that you're working with, we just have to look at it from the satellite and see if it's possible. Otherwise, we'd have to change where the location of the external stairwell will go, because it can't go in the setback, right? Yeah. So what else? What is seed money? We need to have, so get started money. I mean, here's the thing. If you're going to start your project, Meredith's program is the no-brainer, because I think what people need to figure out is, I don't want to deplete my cash reserves. I just don't. Okay. Now, depending upon the project, you got to be careful, because her prices, they may be a little bit different from ours. She handles a lot of areas and territories, so she's giving you general rules. But I think the questions that we want to, or at least the answers to your questions, should be regional. They should be more specific to your city and your county and so forth, because they do vary. And most importantly, it varies by the scope of work. If you have an easy no-brainer job, then your fees are less. But if you've got a very complex problem and we've got to do some creative engineering, it's going to be a little bit more. But we have ways to help you with that. We have discounts, and we even have programs if you stay with us from beginning to end. We have a customer loyalty program which gives some rebates, some of your architectural fees back to you. But I can say, if you're getting started, you're going to want to put $20,000 to $25,000 aside as just getting started money. If you don't want to deplete your cash savings, then Meredith's HELOC is the perfect answer for it. Right, Meredith?
Definitely. Those initial costs, like I said, maybe $15,000, that's like $75 a month. I mean, it's just nothing. So you shouldn't be out of pocket on all this. This can be financed 100%, and the financing is tax deductible. So not just the construction, but the mortgage interest.
You know, and I think it's important to know, if you took a couple of scoops of dirt from under the house using a HELOC, that grows back at an incredibly fast rate, as we all see our housing equity growth in the last couple of years. It takes an eternity to save $20,000 to $25,000. I would never use my hard-earned cash. I would use dirt because it grows back at a fast rate. What do you think, Meredith?
Yeah, I absolutely agree. When we run the data, typically, if you were to put 100% of rent toward these ADUs, they pay themselves off in like 5 years, maybe less. And okay. And I mean, what loan does that? You know what I mean? It's such a great investment. Danny, there's a great question about, can you have more than one ADU on the property? Great question, Mubina. Thank you.
I see you already typed an answer.
I did, but this is important. I should have touched base, and I'll revise it next time. By state law now, every single family zoned property can have up to two houses and two ADUs on them. It's tricky to do. There's some phased approaches we have to take, and we've actually been working out, mostly because my mortgage guidelines haven't caught up with the permit guidelines, but it is doable. So, and you may not want to, you know, build all of that now. You may just want to build one thing, right? But my recommendation is master plan your property. Don't just stick an ADU in the middle of the backyard. Stick it in the back corner, because you never know. Your son or your daughter might get married, might be having grandbabies, and now you want to build another ADU in the backyard or another unit. So that gives you space. By master planning ahead of time, it gives you optionality to build more if you choose.
Right. Incidentally, that question is coming up more and more and more, because new legislation is paving the way to allow people to do stuff. That's a conversation we should probably do on a video call, so we can look at your plot of land and determine what's the best master plan for you. We can help you with that. If the main house is already rented out, you can't do SB9, right, Meredith? I think she was asking, does this need to be owner-occupied? No, it does not. How much is the current interest rate on the construction HELOC loan? I don't know the answer to that. Meredith, are you still there? It looks like you froze up a little bit.
I think she has a program for that.
She does have a program for that. I think she just unveiled it tonight. Pamela asked, do you have a HELOC on existing rental property? Yes, we do. Non-owner-occupied, sure do. So if you want to click on her link and you can have a private conversation, feel free to do so, or you can talk to us and we can help facilitate that, whatever you want to do. But I think we are approaching finish. We have one more thing before we sign off.
One more question. Does it cost more to have a high vaulted ceiling or at a soft loft space?
Yeah. So when you do a high vaulted ceiling, that's non-livable space. You're just raising the ceiling up high. The question is how tall are we doing it? Am I building it two stories high? Well, it's going to probably end up costing more because I'm building a two-story building. Loft space, if you're going to use it as living space, you're going to put a bed there, you're going to sleep there, you're going to use it as a room, we have to have a minimum of 7 feet of head clearance there. And we're right up there at two stories now. So yes, it will be priced out similar to a two-story space. Can it be done? Yes.
Sleeper lofts are more expensive than storage lofts. Storage lofts are a ladder where you put storage up there like Christmas decorations. Sleeper lofts have a stairwell where you walk up there and it's going to support the weight of furniture and a body. Now that requires underpinning down below. So there's a difference in cost. I don't want to let the cat out of the bag too soon, but I'm doing two projects in downtown LA and they're on the same property and they're studios with one has a sleeper loft and one has a storage loft, and they're about a month and a half away, but this would give you the option of walking into both of them, looking at them side by side, when you can determine which one is right for you. And that's, we're probably 2 months away on that one, on those two rather, okay? Anyway, we are gonna do one last thing and call it a night. I appreciate everybody sticking around. We went long, 2 hours. You guys hung in there, I appreciate that. So we'll play the last video, Vic. Yep. And we'll show you our design team. And again, the customer care, as you're watching the video, the customer care division will be on staff in the morning and we'll try to reach out to everybody. So if we didn't get you tonight, no big deal. We'll get you tomorrow. We'll try our best, okay?
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. And thank you, Meredith.
Thank you, Meredith.
Okay, we have one last item before we wrap it up for tonight's show. Please stay on two more minutes and meet the architectural design team in a short video and tour of our offices in Glendale. We hope you'll subscribe to our monthly webinar as we have new ideas on ADU design tips, value engineering ideas, controlling your construction budget, and listening to new speakers each month to get a variety of advice and recommendations for your own ADU projects. Thanks for coming and we'll see you next month. Welcome, friends, to ADU Resource Center in beautiful downtown Glendale, California, right on Brand Avenue in the U.S. Bank Building, where we have plenty of free parking. Come on up to the fifth floor and say hi to our design team. While we take a short elevator ride up, I'll tell you a little bit about our company and what our services are. ADU Resource Center is a one-stop shop, and that simply means we take care of everything relating to the project. That means anything from architectural designs, structural engineering, Title 24 energy calculations, low impact development calculations, and permit expediting. The design team is on staff. We do everything on the fifth floor. And as we walk into the building, you'll notice two conference tables for our customers so they can come down and sit with us and design and look at the big screen and figure things out together. During peak season, we might have several customers in at the same time. So we offer private rooms so that we can keep privacy and noise down. This is our private conference room with a beautiful view of the San Gabriel Valley Mountains. And what a view. Does it help us design better with inspiration? Oh, you better believe it does. So the next room we're going to go into is the architectural design room where Santa's little helpers do all their magic. Well, that about wraps up our quick office tour. I hope you enjoyed it. Here's the printer where we print out all your plans. Come on down to ADU Resource and let us help get started on your design today.